Lesson number 7, if you will, in your booklet. Lesson number 7. So we've been talking, again, this is 8 lessons, and we've kind of condensed about 20 hours worth of real study and doing into just a 8, well, really 6 lessons, if you will. So there is a lot of information that we're not, that is going to be here. If you look back through some of the earlier lessons from last time, we didn't read every page. You can do that. We are going to really pay attention now going forward, because I realize that I say you can read it and you won't read it unless I read it with you. And every seminar moving forward will not be where we have this kind of a handout. Some of them coming will be me teaching more than looking at a booklet. It doesn't mean that you won't have a handout and so forth. So come over. Well, all right, lesson 7, learning how to farm. And this is an interesting idea about farming. And when you talk about farming, there's really more going on than what's on these pages in the lesson. And you will never be the same when you have a clear understanding of the gospel of grace and a logical way to present it. And when you have seen it change lives in real flesh and blood situations. And this issue about farming is an issue that really gets down to the crux of what we're doing today, this lesson and the next lesson, okay? The next couple lessons here. Because someone told me, said something to me last time about, I don't have a passion for. I don't have this. How do I get the passion? How do I do this? How do I do that? Okay? And really, these two lessons, and then that additional handout we're going to talk about briefly here next hour, begin to identify and address that, because we have to have a purpose. And our purpose is an issue about people. Okay? 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 20, we're ambassadors for Christ. Okay? And come over with me to 2 Timothy, if you will. 2 Timothy and chapter number 4. Because what begins to happen is that we have to have a purpose, and really we have to be sensitive about people. Now, I'm not talking about offending them, okay? And I'm not talking about, well, I'm not going to talk to that group of people because I just can't relate, which is an excuse. I'm not going to go over here and talk to these people. It's not that at all. It's how do we look at people? When you look at the lost of the world, what do you see? You see lost, but what do you see? What you need to be seeing is that that is a soul that is lost, or that is a soul that is a sinner. And we need to be sensitive to this, that when we look at people, we're not looking at a skin color. We're not looking at an economic status. We're looking at a soul. And a piece of you that lives on forever. Remember when we did the real you study? The soul is you. And we need to be sensitive that there are souls out there that need eternal life. And we need to develop a thinking, a passion. I like that word, passion, for people. Okay? We've had people come here, knock on the door, call, ask for help. Do you give rent assistance? Well, we don't. Okay? But it isn't that I don't call them back and have a conversation with them. That was in the past, by the way. I don't do that anymore. Because if you do it now, you know what happens? You're open for a lawsuit because you're prejudiced and you're discriminatory, and et cetera, and et cetera. It used to be, I called back some folks, I talked to them, and said, no, we don't offer that, but what else do you need help with and stuff? Tried to find out what their needs were. And then I said, well, listen, our protocol is that you got to come to church and we got to get to know you and we have to be around. Oh, okay. Well, thank you and hang up. Okay. See? So the issue isn't that we don't help people. It's just that we're not the welfare unit. Okay. But see, the thing is we have to develop a passion for people. In the top there, page 39, in our fast-paced society, we view those about us in one of three ways, and this is coming from the psychology realm of everything and sociology, and basically we view people as scenery. That's really how we usually do. And that's the people that are just walking by us every day. We don't think about them. They're there. We don't pay any attention to them. They're just walking by. And if you've ever been on a busy street corner in downtown Chicago, you know what the people are? Scenery. Because there's so many moving by you, you just block them out and you go where you got to go, get what you get done, and then get out. Okay? That's usually how we view people, as scenery. Or we view them as machinery. The waiter, the waitress, they're serving coffee, they're taking the money, directing traffic, little more than just stoplights or drinking fountains. That's how we view them. I can remember as a waiter, I was a waiter, and working on Sunday afternoons, because that's the big church rush, and sitting there, and the people eat their meals and leave, and you know what they leave? They don't leave a tip. You know what they leave? A gospel tract. I've been in the back room of the restaurant, and a lady looks at me, she knows I'm a believer, and she says, this right here is why I don't believe in your God. I can't pay my bills with a track. Don't ever give me a track again. I said, I didn't give it to you. What pays her? What is she there for? Money. Okay, so if you leave a tip or a track, make sure you're leaving a tip. And don't leave 10%. Leave a few more because, you know, they're there to work. But what do we usually view people? We just think about the waitress or the waiter, and we just keep moving, don't we? See. But what do we need to really view them as? As people, as a real person with whom a genuine relationship is possible. And I'll be honest with you, the issue from this study and then the next one about outside beyond the church walls is this issue right here. It's about viewing people as that soul that's going to spend eternity somewhere, because they are, aren't they? And in the work of, you've got 2 Timothy 4, in the work of evangelism, we must endeavor to break through to others on a personal level. As we become genuine people to our prospects, that will give our message a genuine hearing. You need to remember that. You need to be genuine. When you look at that waitress and you leave a track on the table and you're 10% in it, okay, or whatever you leave, you need to understand that, honestly, that track's going to go in the garbage and never be read. So instead of leaving a track, why don't you stop the young lady or the gentleman and have a conversation with them? Talk, and when my dad comes to town, and I'll tell on dad, he's always joking and messing around with the waiter or the waitress. And there's a reason. What's he looking for? An opening to ask the crunch questions, to talk to them about spiritual issues. Okay? And getting them comfortable. Breaking down that barrier of, here's just another table of eight. What are they going to leave me today? Hey, I've been there, done that. I know what they're thinking. See? You know what they're thinking. Well, hey, when you leave them some money, and what happens is you've had a conversation with them, then what begins to happen? Hey, now there's a breakdown in that barrier. Now there's a genuineness. You have become real to them. You have to understand, when you go into a restaurant, or really when you go anywhere, you're not real to them. You're a commodity. See, your machinery, your scenery, that's how they're viewing you. So what do we got to do? We got to break all that down. See, We have to do 2 Timothy 4, verse number 5. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. Doing the work of evangelism requires some deliberate planning and deliberate thinking. That's why, right above the line, as believers, we should live with a purpose as well as with a passion. To do so effectively, we must also live with a plan. The three P's again. Folks, you develop your plan, you work in your plan, but now you got to put passion in there. By the way, remember, that's in lesson three, last time. You got to have some passion in there, because who are you looking at? You're looking at who? You're looking at a soul. Okay? You're looking at someone who can spend eternity in heaven or eternity in hell. That's who you're looking at. And you need to remember that. You need to think about that. Below the line there, the Bible does not teach that God orchestrates divine providential appointments with lost people in the dispensation of grace. By the way, if He did, they would not be lost. Because what would God do to them if He was divinely, providentially getting involved in their lives? What would He do to them? Save them. He can do that. I mean, He does do that. He'd just save them. See, He's not working that way, see. But rather, we as ambassadors are called to proactively engage all lost people with the gospel. We must do the work of an evangelism. By the way, work. Labor, toiling, energy, commitment, thinking about it, organization, organizing out, getting in. Work must be deliberate and planned for. Come over to Ephesians 5. Come back to Ephesians 5. Folks, we've done all the other lessons to really get to this lesson. You need to understand the three critical issues. You need to understand the crunch questions. You need to understand how to talk to people. You need to have the book, the verses in your memory. You need to have them identified on your phone. You need to develop a plan. You need to be working down through it with yourself. Stand in front of the mirror and talk to yourself in the mirror. I do it all the time. My wife thinks I'm nuts. But, you know, hey, having a conversation with yourself is okay, even beginning to argue with yourself. But when you start asking yourself to repeat yourself, now we're going to have the problem with you, okay? All right, but see, the thing is because what are we at? We're after this passion for the lost. Ephesians 5, notice verse 16. Paul says, redeeming the time because the days are evil. Notice that. Because the days are evil and we're to be redeeming the time, what should we be doing? We should have a plan. We should have a purpose. We should have a passion, right? When I worked for Bash's years ago, my first 3-4 years at Bash's was catching shoplifters. And we were taken through extensive training. What are you looking for? How to identify them? What are the things that you got to know for the report writing we're going to do? How do you know if now we've got to go to court? How do you do that? And all this stuff. But in the identification, I got to where you could walk in the front door, I knew if you were going to steal or not. I could look and sell. I go, no, they won't. Oh, he will. Let's watch him. Or let's watch her. Wait a minute, she's got a stroller with no kid in it. All right, let's watch what's going to happen. Oh, she's got a stroller with a kid in it. Well, let's watch. I'm walking in from lunch. I'm not clocked in. A guy's pushing. He's pushing a basket full and pulling a basket full right out the door unbagged. That is not normal behavior, right? But what did I learn to do? I learned to look at people not as souls, but as what? Shoplifters, see? All right? I got a lady in the room talking to her. Mike, I always ask why. I always like to hear. I didn't care. She's going, the cops are called. They're on their way. We're doing our job. I just want to know why. All the excuses, right? You ask them why. They tell you, well, you know, my check isn't here from the government yet, or this or that, blah, blah, blah. Saddest day was I had two boys under the age, minors. They're sitting there, and I ask them why, and the one boy hits the other boy, and he's like, shut up, don't say a word. And I said, no, too late. Well, Mom sent us. I'm like, really? She goes, yeah, Mom sent us down here. So I looked at the store director, and I said, you need to call Mesa PD, please. Okay? We call Mom, because that's our job. Job's to call Mom. Mom's on her way. Mom walks in the door, did not see the officer sitting behind the door, and says, I told you guys not to get caught. Guess where she went? She didn't go home. See? And the children went off to Grandma. Grandma came and got them and stuff. Okay? See? You hear all different, but what do you begin to look at people as what? Not as souls, but as troublemakers, right? Our job as ambassadors isn't to look at them that way. Our job is to look at them as what? Lost souls. Now, are they troublemakers? Well, sure. Why? They're sinners. And what do you want to do? You want to take their heads and whack them together, right? Okay. But what do you do? They're souls. If you will look at that paragraph there, time. It's after 2 Timothy 3:10 there in the parentheses, about midway. By the way, 2 Timothy, time is a valuable and important commodity that should be viewed as a stewardship. Once it is lost, it can never be recouped. We have learned to measure time, but have we learned to master it? Intentional forethought must be given to our work. Things won't just happen unless we make it happen. Now look over at 2 Timothy 3, okay, at that verse in verse 10. 2 Timothy 3:10. Our apostle Paul lived with a purpose, and he did it from day one of him being converted on the road to Damascus. 2 Timothy 3:10, but thou hast fully known my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience, persecution, affliction, and so on. What do we know? We've fully known. Nothing's left out about Paul's what? His doctrine, his manner of life, his purpose. If you cross the page to chapter 4 and verse number 7, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. What's he saying there? Hey, I did my purpose. Not only am I the apostle of the Gentiles, but I'm out here seeing people get saved and then coming to the knowledge of the truth. I got a purpose. And when you and I are dealing or we're talking with people, and again, we are to be looking at people as who they are, and that is people. Souls, not machinery, not scenery. You go into this afternoon you're going to eat lunch here, but you go down and eat dinner tonight and you sit down at the table and they come in and they bring in lunch and you look at the waiter and you say, well, this isn't done right, whatever, and you get it done, you get it. But who are you talking to? Not a machine, not yet anyway, but you're talking to a person, a soul. So now, when you go to the restaurant, you are to talk to them with some intention. What is our intention? To see what their spiritual condition is. Follow that? By the way, this is the toughest lesson, because this is hard. Because we have to retrain how we think about people. Follow? You understand that? That's... Because when we talk about farming here, okay, that's what we're talking about. Now we're having a change in how we think about people because we don't want to waste what? Time. How many of you have had arguments with people where eventually you just said, this is a waste of my time? Look at the political scene here the last year. It's a waste of time. It's a waste of energy, isn't it? But we're all in it. And we all do it. Every one of you in here does it. Even you. Okay? But see, the thing is what? It becomes a waste. We don't want to waste our time. We want to enjoy the steak and the potatoes and the soup and the salad, but we want to also look for that opportunity to get involved with them on a spiritual basis. The bottom of page 39, the definition of a farm. A major problem we face in evangelism will continue to be finding those who are willing to receive our gospel presentation. Thus, we will need to develop what we will call a farm. Although not exactly a scriptural term, it does suit our purposes. A farm is a list of those people to whom we are to relate so that they might have the benefit of such evangelism, instruction, or spiritual concern as we can give. Basically, what a farm is people, go to page 40, the basic source, what you're talking about is prospects. Now, whether you make a list or not, as is suggested here, that is up to you. But basically, there are two basic sources of soul-winning prospects. There's the cold market, and then there's the warm market. What do you think the warm market is? People you know, family, friends, relatives, your neighbors. Well, I don't know my neighbor. Well, you should know your neighbor. Okay? And what we're trying to do is go develop relationships there. Then you got the cold market guy. Now, this is the guy on that you're out knocking on doors or passing tracks or meeting at the swap meet, okay? But what are you trying to do? You're still trying to develop a relationship to them. But in that developing of a relationship, what you're doing is you're demonstrating to them that you are real, that you are genuine, and that you have a real interest in them. You're not as scenery or as machinery, but as who they are, and that is that lost soul. Because what are we after? We're after an opportunity to share the gospel with them. And again, the goal there under letter B, the key here is to move our cold prospects to warm prospects, because our goal is to share the gospel with friends, new and old, at their earliest point of reception, where they'll receive it. So what do? Instead of viewing people as just pieces of the landscape or pieces of that you got to deal with, they're now what? They're souls. And they're 9.9% of them out of 10 are dying and on their way to hell. And then you develop yourself to become soul sensitive. So now, I was coming down the road the other day and I didn't think I did what the guy yelled at me that I did. And when he gave me the three-finger salute, okay, I was sitting there looking at him going, you know, dude, you're lost and on your way to hell. You ought to be nicer to me. Now, that's the wrong thing to think, okay, because I wasn't exactly happy what he did to me. And then when I got done, we got to the stoplight, I'm like, well, maybe I ought to rethink how I thought about that, you know, because what is he? He is a soul lost to hell, going to hell, and what should I do? Romans 12. Avenge not. Vengeance is mine, said the Lord. I'll repay. What am I supposed to do? I'm supposed to look at him and say, yeah, well, I appreciate the salute, but by the way, yeah. See, the issue is to become soul sensitive. When you talk to somebody and you ask them the crunch questions and you begin to talk to them about the Lord, a lot of times they think you're going to sell something to them. Come to our church. And oh, by the way, we got a building program, right? Oh, by the way, we need this or that. Oh, hey, yeah, come over here and join this. What you got to do is you got to get them to understand you're not selling anything. You're genuine and you're real. In the development of a farm there in point number two, again, if you look at number one under A, using existing networks, you see that friends, relatives, associates, and neighbors? You ought to make a list of people that you know in that realm that's unsaved. Talking about living with a purpose, you ought to sit, make a list, put it down on paper. You know, they say goals not written down or goals never achieved. Oh, I'll just keep it up here in my head. No, you'll never get it down. Write it down. You'll never get it done. Write it down. Make a list. Take some time. Think about it. Become soul sensitive. Think about people that you know. By the way, maybe you know people who are saved, but they're in the wrong message. Write those people down. Hey, there's an opportunity to go share right division with them. Let's think about those guys. See, you can do this in both. The issue is you're becoming what? Soul sensitive. Sensitive to the souls of the people that you know, your friends, your relatives, your associates, your neighbors, and you make a list here. By the way, how many times do they need to hear it? Seven hears, three touches. That's the least. Okay, and more. See, so when you become the issue here about developing your farm, and you'll hear that sometimes people will say, "How's your farming going?" Well, that's what they're talking about. But as you begin to develop that list, you know what really quickly said? You really quickly can put yourself underneath a guilt trip of, oh my goodness, I ain't doing so good. Don't do that. Move forward. I told you last month when we first started, you might not have been doing anything. It's time to move forward. Don't go backwards and think, oh my goodness, look at all this stuff in the past. You'll never change that. Why? Because time's gone. You'll never recoup it. What do you do now? Now we move forward. See? Because your goal is letter B, and that's to win a hearing. That's what you're after. What are you after? You're after that opportunity to give them the gospel. Talk to them about their soul and where they're going to be for eternity. Number one there, we must constantly be moving those on our cold list to our warm list. Everyone wants to be loved and respected. Everyone wants to be accepted and treated like a friend. If we repeatedly reach out through personal concern and touch the people we want to lead to Christ, it builds a bond between us that will make it easier for them to accept us, our friends, and ultimately our Savior. That's very important. That's vital. Okay? It really is that we stop and we say, look, this, we're going to be thinking this way now. Ask yourself this question. What are you doing with purpose and intent to find someone who's unsaved and lead them to the Lord? What are you doing? What's our goal? Give them the gospel. That's our goal. What are you doing? That's a heavy question. By the way, it's a question that I ask of myself all the time. So don't think I'm asking you without first running it through this dude, okay? My point is what are you doing? Come over to the book of Titus. Titus 2. I'm going to talk a little bit more here about this in a minute on looking at in lesson 8 there on learning to look beyond the church walls. If you will, you got Titus 2. Look at the bottom of page 40 in lesson 7, number 2. And this is important. Do not become impatient or get discouraged if your warm list does not respond immediately. Continue on because they will respond if we continue to reach out with a personal concern. Remember to always do good. See that? You got Titus 2. Run back there to Galatians 6. Just look at these verses in the list here. Galatians 6. What's our goal, guys? Give the gospel. What do we do? We got to move people that we're just acquainted with on a very generic manner over into our warm list. We're going to make a list of everybody we know who's unsaved. We're going to figure it out. We're going to do it. And then what we're going to do, we're going to begin to generate, and we're going to become soul conscious, and we're going to begin to generate personal relationships with all of those folks. That takes time. That takes work. It takes energy. Okay? Galatians 6 and verse number 10. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. We're to do good unto who? All men. See that? Do good. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter number 5 and verse number 15. You need to understand, folks, that we need to be doing good. This is a dying world out there where nobody's kind, nobody's considerate, nobody's caring, nobody's doing good. Well, we don't want to get walked all over. You know, they'll just, if we do good, they're just going to walk all over you. Wait a minute. Christ said, when you're weak, I'm strong. We're not to be of the world, are we? What does the world say? Look strong. Don't let anybody walk all over you. But wait a minute. What did Christ say? Do good. Be walked on. Be abused. Look at 1 Thessalonians 5:15. See that none render evil for evil unto any man, but ever follow that which is good, both among yourselves and to all men. What are we to be doing? We're to be doing good. So when we develop our list and when we look at people, and we think about your coworkers. There's a lady at the yard. She knows I'm a pastor. We've had conversations over the years. I get off a little after 5. She's off at 4:30. She waited for me yesterday. She ran down. She missed me coming into the building. I'm out in the parking lot. I'm getting on my motorcycle. She's waving me down. I'm like, uh-oh. She comes up and she says, do you have a minute? I have a question. I'm like, sure, what you got? 1 Thessalonians 4 and 5, when it talks about sleep, what is that? Is that sleeping in a bed, taking a nap, or is that death? I said, it's death. And we spent 10 minutes talking about that information. Now, she doesn't like right division because it excludes too much, she says, okay? But what did she do? She knows that what? She knows that she can come here to me. I've given her our information. She said she's watched some stuff. I don't know. Okay? And get what? The truth. But that is a cold member, cold list member who's warming up to become a warm. But I only see her, like I said, she's off at 4:30. I'm off at 5. I don't run into her very often. You follow that? Just be so sensitive. Thinking about, hey, who am I looking at? Who are we? We're ambassadors for Christ with a message of grace and peace from God our Father. Right? Then as an ambassador, and that is job number one in my life, who is my audience? All men. So then what do I need to be? I need to learn. I need to develop. I need to get in. I got to have the doctrine and all that. I got that. But what do I need to begin to learn as I'm dealing with all men? Number one is to do good, by the way. Because what do you have to be in order to gain the hearing? You got to be genuine. You got to be real. You got to be caring about them. You got to be concerned with them. Titus 2. Look at Titus 2. Titus is an interesting book. Titus 2 and verse number 14. Who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of what? Good works. Now, watch chapter 3 and watch verse 14. Chapter 3 and verse 14. And let ours also learn, notice you're going to learn to maintain good works for what? Necessary uses. Well, isn't giving the gospel a necessary use? What am I going to learn? What do I got to do? I got to come in. I got to learn some things. Paul said, I've learned in whatsoever state I am to be with content. I'm going to take in some doctrine. I'm going to take in some knowledge. I'm going to begin to learn. Folks, if someone dies today and they're not in Christ, where do they go? They go to hell. Eternal damnation. Eternal lake of fire. Eternally separated from the love of God. See? We know that. We learned that, haven't we? Okay? But I'm learning that so that I can maintain good works. for necessary use. Now watch the end of the verse. That they, what? Who's the they? The good works are what? Are not unfruitful. This isn't about you. It's about what? It's about the good works. And it's necessary. And we need to learn to be fruitful. And in the area of evangelism, we need to get out of our comfort zone and look at who do we know. Everyone in this room that works a job, you've got coworkers that are on your cold list that you've never had a conversation with. I mean, I do. I know. I look at my lounge, the driver's lounge, I'm like, man, I've never talked to that person before. So what should I do? I should go over there and talk to them. I sit down at the table. They get up and leave. I'm like, Everything. I took a shower. I brushed my teeth. Right? Well, okay. I'll try it again tomorrow. Go over there. Sit down. Then they sit there. You sit there and you say, hey, how you doing? I'm Rick. Oh, hey, I'm Bill. Oh, good to meet you, Bill. What do you think about the safety meeting the other day? Get them to talking. Break down those, who are you? And what do you want? Oh, by the way, I'm selling Girl Scout cookies. No, you're not doing that. No. Hey, I got a question for you. I see you sitting here usually by yourself and so forth. Have you ever thought about spiritual issues? And you're just right into it. Because what does the guy need? Oh, yeah, I've thought about spiritual issues. A bunch of hokey stuff, a bunch of malarkey. Oh, okay. Now I know it's going to be some heavy treading through this, you know? But what do? You're looking for that opportunity to do the work of an evangelist. Folks, come back to Romans 1. I'm going to get off track here a little bit. Look at Romans 1 with me. Romans chapter number 1. By the way, the rest of lesson 7, you can read down through that stuff about the farm, how to keep it, how to develop it there on page 41, where you can invite a friend, you can offer to do some things for them, you can send a card, you can look down through about keeping the list and everything, in the beginning of your farm. So if you can do all that, if you don't do it, God's not going to strike you dead where you sit, but I'm going to stand over here just in case. He's not going to do any of that, okay? It's just some information to help you. I want you to look at Romans 1 with me. Look at verse number 14. Start in verse 13. Now I would not have you ignorant, brethren, that oftentimes I purposed to come unto you, but was let hitherto. Why did he want to come to them? That I might have some fruit among you also, even as among other Gentiles. Now watch verse 14. I am debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarian, both to the wise and to the unwise. So as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. Do you see that issue about him being a debtor in verse 14? Why in the world did Paul say that he's a debtor to the world? Why is he a debtor to the world? What does verse 15 say? As much as in me is, I am ready to do what? Preach the what? The gospel. See that? He's a debtor to the world because what does he have? He's got the gospel. See that? So then guess what? You and I are in the same condition as Paul. We are a debtor to the world. You know why? Because we have the gospel of the grace of God, the gospel of Christ, verse 16. See that? Man, when you grasp that, you grasp that our responsibility is everybody. Now, are we going to reach the world? Not necessarily, but what can we do reach? Our family, friends, relatives, neighbors, right? People we come in contact. Every day you go to the grocery store, you walk through the who's standing there? Well, unless you use the self-checkout line, there's usually somebody standing there. That's a great opportunity to just get a conversation started. Hey, how you doing? Yeah, good. Oh, yeah, I'm winter visiting. I'm here for the winter. Oh, really? Yeah, I'm from, you know, Chicago, and I'm here. Great. Well, wonderful. Do you live around here? Are you local? Yeah, I live down the street. Oh, wonderful. Great. Hey, thanks. We'll see you next time. Oh, by the way, my name's Rick. Next time in, who are you looking for? Well, you know her name because she's got a tag. You're looking for Lucy. Where's Lucy? Or Hilga or whatever, okay? Now you see Lucy, and guess what you do? On purpose, you go through her line. Well, wait a minute, there's a full basket in front of me. Doesn't matter. What's your purpose? My purpose is to take Lucy to the next step in our relationship. Lucy, yeah, I'm Rick. We talked the other day. Oh, yeah, great. Hey, how you doing? How's the family? You got married? I see a ring on the finger. You married? Great. Got kids? I'm a granddad. I'm a grandpa, I'm a grandma, whatever. But what are you doing with Lucy? You're developing the fact that you're real. Okay? And making her feel loved, accepted, desired, wanted, talked to. But you, by purpose, do what? Go right through Lucy's line. And then what happens? Then about the third or fourth time, you ask them, do you go to church? Or you ask a crunch question to get an opening or something. You don't have to carry, you can't carry on a conversation there with her and run her through Romans Road, because what is she doing? She's working, and now you're the backup. But what can you do? You can develop a relationship to where you can say, hey, look, we're going to get together, in a couple, next week or something. Can I invite you to, here's my number and stuff, and we got a thing going on at church on Saturday. We'd love for you to come. You can then develop a way into the door to say, hey, because what do you know? She's married, she's got kids, her husband's a jerk, the kids are out of line, or, the typical life things. And what can you do? And she hates her job because she's working, dealing with you, okay? But what are you now? Now you're real. You see how you do that? But what did you do? Intentionally, you met her. Intentionally, you went through her line every time through. I was at Bash's the other day. I'm getting a donut on my break. Several weeks ago now, actually. And I was standing behind a gentleman that was at the bakery counter. And him and the lady behind the bakery counter had a 10-minute conversation. While she's helping me, because he's been coming in there ordering the same blueberry muffin or fritter for the last 5 years, she knows everything about him, he knows everything about her, and he's old enough to be her granddad. See? And he's just been coming in every day. And I'm like, now there you go. The content. Because you go everywhere. Now, in this society, what begins to happen is the machines are in the way now a little bit more. So what do we have to do? And intentionally go in and pay the cashier to get gas at the pump. Well, it's not convenient. I'm time. Well, you make those decisions. You'll answer to God, okay? But what are you doing? You're intentionally getting going. You follow that? Why? Because we're a debtor. What do we have? We have the message. So we're a debtor. Follow that? So learning the farm and learning to move along is going to be very important. Okay? Now go to lesson 8 quickly here. You're in Titus. We're going to do this for, are you guys okay for another half hour roughly? Okay? And then I got to stop the tapes, and then we'll have a little bit to go over the last stuff and finish up. Okay, you got Titus, right? Stay in the book of Titus. Go to book of Titus. Learning to look beyond the church walls, lesson 8, session 8. Okay? you got Titus. Stick something in that. Run back with me to 1 Thessalonians. There's a quote at the top of the page, 1 Thessalonians 1. It's a question. Have we been so preoccupied with defining the gospel, which is important? I'm on page 44 at the top. and defending the gospel, which is also important, that we have neglected declaring the gospel, which is tragic. Has the church become sinfully silent? What a question. That goes with what we're talking about being soul sensitive. That's why we're going to do these together, okay? See that? Folks, we shouldn't be soul sensitive, sinfully silent. We should be declaring at every turn where we can, when appropriate, again, I'm not talking about being out there knocking heads and busting knees, okay? Because then I'll be visiting you down at Maricopa County Jail, okay? I'm not talking about doing something that's outside of your realm, your comfort zone. But what I am talking about is in your comfort zone, intentionally seeking to talk to people about their souls. Okay, follow that? Okay. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse number 5. For our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Ghost and in much assurance, as ye know what manner of men we speak among you for your sakes. And ye became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Ghost. So what did they? They received the word, didn't they? They heard it, they believed it, they're following Paul. Verse 7. So that ye were in samples to all that believe in Macedonia and Achaia. For from you, notice, sounded out the word of the Lord. Not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place your faith to God were to spread abroad, so that we need not to speak anything. How in the world, how do you view ministry? Look at your page there on 44. How do you view it? Most of us view it as that first box. We come in here, we get, this is ministry, is done in here. We learn, we grow, okay? That's the traditional viewpoint. We go to church to learn and to grow. And then when we go out in the week, we're just living life and we're just taking care of bills and raising kids and feeding families and doing, and we don't think any more of it. The second box is where we need to be thinking. Because when we leave church on Sundays and Wednesday nights and so forth, there's more to ministry than just the sound doctrine. There's a ministry of sounding out the word of the Lord. You see that in verse 7? There's more going on there. And really, this is our challenge, quite honestly. It is, unfortunately, the very concept of ministry has been degraded by ecclesiastical forces, which is religion. And that is that it's limited only to what goes on inside the four walls of the church building at predetermined times of the week. That's usually how we think about it. Even us here, ministry means service. Ministry is serving people. Again, people, souls. Ministry is you. Folks, when I look at us here, and in my position as a pastor, my job is to minister to you that are sitting here, to build you up, to encourage you, that as you then go in the day-to-day businesses of your life, that you then are doing what? Ministry as well. Why do you think we're going to spend the next good chunk of this year talking about our ambassadorship? A topic that is really never discussed specifically. It's discussed in but never specifically. Ministry is you. It's serving at the very moment of time in every place you find yourself in. Please underline that. Please memorize that. Service is everywhere that you're at is ministry. Come over to 1 Timothy chapter 2. It's everywhere that you're at. Every place you find yourself in is it's ministry time. And when you can develop a mindset of witnessing to people in the natural context of our daily lives, that's going to take, again, learning. It takes figuring out. We must work consciously, determinedly, and daily to develop a witnessing way of life. There are opportunities for witnesses all around us. Our responsibility is to develop alertness of mind and zeal for sharing God's love that will enable us to take advantage of every opportunity. Evangelism is a lifestyle. It is not a program. It is a lifestyle. It's a developing. We're going to develop this out. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to do A, and then I'm going to talk about B, and we're going to talk about C. I got my plan. Now I'm out in the grocery store, or I'm at wherever, the ballpark. Okay? The races are a little tough because it's a little loud. Okay? But what am I doing? I'm consciously now looking for an opportunity to develop a relationship so that I can have a chance to share. It's everything in me to get you to catch that, okay? 1 Timothy 2, notice verse number 8, the first part of this verse. We're talking about this in Sunday school, but I will therefore that men pray everywhere. Everywhere you go, you're doing ministry. In the verse here, you got to be praying. Follow that? Folks, if you can catch that evangelism is a lifestyle and not a program. I told you when we first got started, we're not about door knocking. We're not about banging on doors and going visitation. We're not talking about phone calling. We're not talking about hanging this or that. We're talking about developing a strategy that it works for you and who you are, with a soul conscious of, when I run into people, you know what they are? I don't see the postman. I don't see the police officer, the firefighter, the mayor, the governor, the legislature, the bus driver, the supervisor. What I see is lost souls in those positions. And when I see that and I begin to think that way, then you know what? It won't take long that when I receive my parcel from the post guy, it's, oh, hey, by the way, I got something for you, and give him a track. Just read it sometime, hoping that he does. Or, hey, I got a question for you. You've been delivering my mail now for 20 years. Actually, we've only had two mailmen in 20 years, okay? And the second guy, he's a little standoffish, and that's okay. Hey, you've been delivering my mail. You guys ever leave your garbage man a Christmas card with a tip in it? You oughta. You ought to do that. We used to do it for the newspaper boy, didn't you? And the mail guy. You ought to do that sometime. Think about, put it in there, put it on. Make sure he sees it before he dumps it in the back end. You know? Why? Because what did that just do? You're no longer just a garbage can. Now it's like, hey, there's an opportunity. Those people there. Yeah. Oh, man. Yeah. Hey, I've gone out. I haven't done it yet. Just something I've been thinking about. But I was out the other day. We did some remodeling at the house, and I had to dump the can twice. And I had my pile right there by the can, and I heard him coming. And he goes, oh, yeah, go ahead. He got out and helped me. I'm like, cool, I still got more to dump. But the thing is now what do I have? Now when he sees me, he saw me yesterday, he waved at me and kept, and now I got what? I got a warm, fuzzy feeling through the windshield, don't I? But what can happen? Hey, you got a minute, 1 minute, and go up and give him some, talk to him, see? If you look there at that quote from Paul Bormann, I'm trying to get somewhere here. Somehow, tragically, much of the Christian church has substituted other goals and objectives for preaching the gospel. Christianity has taken on the characteristics of the heathen religions around us, building up memberships, constructing temples, making adherents, raising funds, performing ceremonies, attending meetings, saying prayers, building schools, organizations, and denominations, etc. Until today, Christianity has come to be merely another sect or religion, and that's too bad. The world seemingly no longer realizes that Christians have been entrusted by God with a vital message, a message of life and death, and that our responsibility is to deliver this message to every person. Folks, Christianity around the world. It's interesting that the hospitals usually carry a Christian name on it somewhere, usually. Okay, it used to. Nowadays, big companies have bought them up. Okay. The impact of Christianity around the world over the ages has been tremendous, but you know what's begin to look, it's been getting lost. And what has happened on this on page 45 is that we've had an issue of isolationism. Where we become just over here by ourselves. If you look under that issue of isolation, many believers actually avoid any connection with the world, mistaking it for spirituality. I don't know how many of you on my Facebook saw my little t-shirt thing I posted there about your first mistake was thinking that I'm a pastor, like a normal, I messed it up. I bought the shirt, by the way, so I'll have to wear it for you. You know what, when people look at me and they say, oh, you're a pastor? Oh yeah, I'm a pastor. And it blows their minds, because you know what the world thinks about a pastor? Yeah. Stuff shirt. Okay? So you know what people do? Christians get isolated and they don't want to be a part of the world because, well, spiritually we're just better off. But you know what begins to happen is they begin to develop this rabbit hole Christianity mindset. You know what a rabbit does in its hole? In the morning, they pop up out of their safe Christian homes, hold their breath at work, scurry home to their families, and then off to their Bible studies. And finally, end the day praying for the unbelievers for safely avoiding all day. That's rabbit hole mentality. You come out right on my route, you'll see the rabbits. You know what they do? They pop up, they scurry about, and then they're gone. That's what most Christians think right there. What did Thessalonians do? From you what? Sound it out. What's ministry about? We need to learn. We need to grow. We need to get busy about being outside of our comfort zone. So you have some cures for isolationism. You, by the way, get Titus, because that's where we need to be, okay? If you look at that issue, that passage there under the problem of isolationism, we don't have the time to run those verses, but you need to run those verses, because Paul says, shame on you for that. You shouldn't be that way. You got Titus. Just look at one of them. Look at Philippians 1 with me. I'm sorry. Philippians 1. We've been sitting now not quite an hour. I'll give you a break here in just a minute. Philippians 1, verse 27. Philippians 1, 27. Only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that ye stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the Gospels. Of the Gospel. And in nothing terrified by your adversary. That's it right there. You know why we stay isolated out? We're terrified. We don't want to suffer. We don't want to rock the boat. We don't want to offend anybody. I'm not talking about being obnoxiously offending people. Talking about going along and saying, hey, look, you know what my job is as an ambassador? And it's to sound out the word. And the first thing, in order for anyone to ever understand right division or dispensational Bible study, they got to be saved. The thing that people need to understand their Bible is the Holy Spirit. How do we get the Holy Spirit? Being justified, right? Without justification, they'll never understand the Scripture. That's why when somebody says, hey, what about this verse? The first thing out of your mouth said shouldn't be, well, you know, the Apostle Paul, our Apostle, blah, blah. First thing is, well, let me ask you a question first. If you were to die today, where are you going to spend eternity? And if they go, well, I don't know, then they will never understand the right answer to the verse. See? You guys, you got to think about that. Verse 29, for unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ not only to believe on Him, but also to what? Suffer for His sake. Woo. Folks, it's not just enough to believe Him. You got to be out there doing the work of the ministry. And when you're out there doing what you do as who you are in Christ, and you're running up against the lost and dying world out there, it's an evil world. They're not going to like you. But what about you do they not like? The message you're proclaiming. Follow that. You got to catch. So what do we be? We become isolated because we don't want that. Paul says, no, there's a cure for it. And the cure, if you look there on page 45, you'll see a three points to it. We must engage the lost under the cure for isolationism. We must engage the lost. We must step out of our comfort zones and without compromising, get involved with real people, their needs, struggles, and intellectual doubts. Boy, isn't that the case today? Applying the principle of bridge building. Is your life, warts and all, a bridge or a channel for the gospel? Boy, what a question. Think about that. Evangelism should be relational. You're going to build a bridge. Confrontational, you're going to test the bridge. And then proclamational, you're going to cross the bridge. Now, look at relational, where you're going to build the bridge. You're going to develop bridges with people. You're going to befriend people. You're going to remember the friends, relatives, acquaintances, and neighbors. We are instructed to love and to do good toward all men, aren't we? This is especially true given the current culture that we sit in today. Look, if you will, at Titus 2. Titus chapter 2. Titus is a book that challenges the believer to live a life of good works. And when we get over there and we get to studying it in the local assembly, there is a challenge here. Look at 2:14. The end of that verse. I'm sorry, 2:7. I got ahead of myself. 2:7. In all things showing thyself a pattern of what? Good works. In doctrine, showing uncorruptness, gravity, and so forth. But we're to be a pattern of what? Good works. Verse 14, we're to be zealous of good works. Chapter 3, verse 1, the end of the verse, we're to be ready to what? Good works. Verse 8 of chapter 3, we're to be careful to maintain good works. And then in verse 14, we're always learning to maintain the good works. How do you do that? How do you do this list in verse on page 45, this list in Titus? How about saying thank you? Somebody does something for you, say thank you. I hold the door at work all the time for people. I don't walk through and hold it like that. I hold, step out of the way and let them in. They say thank you. I say you're welcome. Be nice. Be kind. Smile. Say hello. Say good morning. That's not hard. Well, maybe you do. No, it's not hard. You just got to do it. Be kind. Be ye kind. Tenderhearted. Oh. We perform good works for necessary uses. Titus 3:14. What's the necessary use? To win people to Christ. Confrontational. You're going to test the bridge. At some point in our relationship with people, as soon as possible, we must confront them with their need of a Savior. And you know what, folks? That right there is going to cause you some fire and brimstone and anguish. But you know what? You need to do it. Okay? Come over to Acts 17. I'll show you this with Paul. You guys doing okay? Do we need to stretch? We all right? All right, Acts 17. We're going to do these two, and then I need to stop the... Well, we can keep going. Acts 17. In Acts 17, you have Paul on Mars Hill. We're going to just jump right in this for time-wise. Because Paul's approach here that you see, guess what he didn't do? He didn't push around, he didn't beat around the bush with these guys. He went right to them. And he did it on purpose. What's his purpose? To talk to them about, verse 22, then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are too superstitious. For as I passed by and behold your devotions, I found an altar unto this with this inscription, to the unknown God, whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, him declare I unto you. What's he doing? He didn't say, hey, guys, I don't want to offend you, but hang on a minute. He went right to the issue, didn't he? They ignorantly are worshiping wrong. And he, the rest of the passage, begins to develop his argument. Verse 24, God that made the world and all the things therein, seeing that he is the Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hand. Neither is, and he just develops his argument with them. To the point down there that by the time you get down to verse number 30 and 31 and 32, they're done listening to him. And they want to, you come back tomorrow. But what was his, he was confrontational, wasn't he? He goes in there and he goes right to the point. Folks, you never need to fear disputing with people. You need to welcome that. You need to encourage discussion. You got to make folks feel comfortable expressing their views, even if they are wrong. You know why? Because we have confidence in the truth. We know the truth. Well, maybe they bring something up I don't know the answer is. What do you say? I don't know, but I'll find out. Give me your number. Give me your email. By the way, follow-up contact info, and I'll get right back to you. Okay? And then come ask, find somebody, get some help. Because our goal is letter C, proclamation. I'm on the top of page 46. And that is the issue of crossing the bridge. And once you've won a hearing and secured permission, and you follow the steps learned in the presenting of the gospel, you know what you do? You get right in there, you go right across that bridge you've built. Folks, we're going to stop here. We're going to take, just give me enough time to flip everything because of the last here. Folks, you need to learn to farm. You need to learn that when you look at people, they are souls and they're either going to heaven or they're going to hell. And our job as ambassadors is to create that passion. We got to be soul sensitive. And when we run into people, I'm not talking about, well, you know what I'm not talking about. I'm not talking about beating them over the head, you know, hey, well, wham. Because they're going to look at you as a nut job and they will never listen to you. That lady that I used to work with in the restaurant, she won't wait on a Christian table ever again because all she got was tracts that day. It took me 6 months to get a hearing with that woman again. Every time I worked, she made sure she was on the other side of the restaurant. Every time I walked back to get my plate of food for my tables, she went the other direction. She intentionally avoided me because of a group of goofball denominational brethren thinking they're doing something wonderful. And all it did was make it harder to get her the truth. Now, by the way, the track was good. Don't get me wrong. But it did what? It put a stumbling block there. Follow that? Okay? Learn. Get in the Word. What are we talking about? We're talking about people's souls. So what do? We don't not go into the world and go to work. We get out there and we build some bridges and we get going, okay? All right. Give me 5 minutes.